Right. All right. In our last episode, you explained why the presence of this digital code in DNA suggests intelligent design. That's what you just said again. But there have been other attempts to explain the origin of information. Okay, where did it come from? What are these other explanations?
There's a famous book that was written by Jacques Monod, one of the founders of what's now called the molecular biological revolution. He worked at the same time with Watson and Crick and others. And the book was titled Chance and Necessity. And Monod's point was that if you're going to be a scientist, you need to explain things by reference either to chance or random processes on the one hand, or by reference to natural laws, or what he called necessity, the idea of if you drop a ball, it will always fall by necessity according to the law of gravity. So chance, necessity, or the combination of the two is what scientists have in their toolkit, he argued. And the attempts to explain the origin of the information necessary to produce the first life have fallen in one of those three buckets, if you will, either chance explanations, those by reference to natural laws, or those by reference to the combination of the two. And the first approach that was taken by origin of life researchers in the 1950s is they began to first appreciate the complexity of the cell and the information-bearing properties of DNA was the brute chance approach. And this was the idea that, well, you know, you have a bunch of chemicals floating around in a prebiotic ocean or a prebiotic soup, and they start just knocking into each other and binding to one another, and eventually you get a DNA molecule with all the information for building proteins. But when people started doing the calculations on exactly how likely something like that would be, they realized that this wasn't plausible at all. And the origin of life researchers themselves rejected chance within a very few years. There was just too much information, and that made the formation of a functional DNA molecule too improbable, even taking into account the billions of years we've had in the history of the universe. So that approach fell by the wayside very quickly. And then, of course, people have tried other approaches as
yeah.
well.
So first of all, chance can't do it, can't explain where we get this information. Go to the next one, and that is, can natural selection overcome these odds? And does that explain the origin of life?
Before we move on, I just remembered I have an illustration that
okay.
people will get as to why the chance thing doesn't work.
All right.
I used to do this with my students in class when I was a college professor. I'd walk around the room with a bag of Scrabble letters and ask them to pick them out at random, and then go right on the board whatever letter they got. And I tried to make it clear, but we were illustrating the lack of causal power of chance. And almost always you get a long sequence of gibberish, but occasionally you get that students would come up with, by chance, something like cat or Anne or some very short two or three letter word. And then they'd kind of start teasing me like, aha, we proved you wrong. But I would always win that argument. And the way I do it is I just let them continue to choose letters. Point being that if you need only a little tiny bit of information, you can get that by chance. But if you need a lot of information, if you need hundreds or thousands or even billions of nucleotide bases arranged in a precise way, that's not going to arise by chance alone. And origin of life researchers have recognized this and moved on.